The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
It is. That means Marcy Wheeler is here. We get together on Fridays. And who would have thought, Marcy Wheeler, that this morning, every Friday morning, news would start flying out of every corner of the interweb. I'm not even sure where to begin today. Maybe, just maybe, we should begin with NBC News, who in their brilliance, I know it's not the biggest news, but oh my God, they've hired Ronna Romney McDaniel as their newest contributor news analyst. What?
Criminal suspect, right? Yes. So she is one step beyond where Dana Nassel has gotten in Michigan's investigation of fake electors. She's really close buddies with a couple of the people who are some of the most culpable in the fake electors plot in Michigan. And she's one step removed among the people who are kind of scoped out and charged in Trump's D.C. indictment. And NBC decided that was the person that they wanted to come on and pretend had something to say about democracy.
You know, I have the perfect NBC clip to share in the wake of this news. Now, it's from, a few years ago, but it still works. And it features one of yours and my favorite NBC reporters. Here, let's go to the then breaking news.
Oh, NBC's Kim Delanian has some new reporting on something that we talked about at the top of the hour, how the Trump administration is handling the transition with the incoming Biden team, or not handling it, we should say, to a certain extent. This time, it involves our intelligence community. Mm. Kim, what have you learned, sir? Oh, shit. Fuck. Okay.
I think we lost
Ken for a second. We'll try to get him back there.
I never saw that. Isn't that great?
How come he can say shit and fuck and I can't say blowjob?
He can't, but that went out over their air. It was actually right, I guess, right around the time of the inauguration. Ken Delanian, shit, fuck, and that's, I would hope, what executives at NBC are saying right now. It's pretty
just crazy.
It is crazy.
It's just like, and then the reporting on it, like New York Times may have broken the story. It's like, oh, here's what she brings to the table without any mention of the fact that she is part of a coup attempt, right? Like, this is important. Like, oh, we're going to bring her on to talk about politics, but not ask her to testify under oath, which is all she should be doing in public at this point.
Yes. I agree. We've got some funkiness going on with the video, but just bear with us. And if it gets out of sync too much, turn off the video and listen to the audio. That will always work. The interwebs have got gremlins, and they're particularly bitchy today for some reason. So that news, was just the straw today, because the day began, and we should say that we tape this in the morning, Arizona time, in the afternoon, where Marcy Wheeler is in Ireland. But the House this morning passed a $1.2 trillion spending bill to avert a government shutdown. This has been in like three phases, but they got it done. The vote was 286 to 134. The news reports say it'll fund roughly three quarters of the government for the next 6 months. The bill now goes to the Senate, who must somehow pass it before midnight tonight to avert even a partial shutdown of the government this week. And they could potentially do it on Monday without too much damage, but that's what's happening there. And so what happened in the House after the vote? Marge Q. Green filed a motion to vacate Speaker Mike Johnson. The fun never ends, does it?
Yeah, in that case, that may actually backfire. Marge is just the far, it doesn't even make sense to say far right anymore, because everyone left in the House, I mean, like Ken Buck's leaving.
Yes.
He's far right too.
He was Freedom
saved.
Caucus, right? And they
right,
used
they
to be the crazies.
The Freedom Caucus hours before he left. They're all far right, but they're versions of far right. And Marge what may end up happening is that Democrats may say, great, if you try and decapitate the House, if you try and take out Speaker Moses because he calls a vote for Ukraine aid, then we'll go support him. So in other words, it may end up giving him more breathing room, not less, just because Democrats have clear asks out of Johnson. We'll see. You know, it's crazy. Like Republicans are, and it's like, they're like, well, we need more leadership. It's like, you don't want leadership.
No.
You want to destroy America because it serves your fascist plot. I mean, like, right before she did this, Marge spoke to Steve Bannon. Steve Bannon doesn't care about America. Steve Bannon doesn't care about anything except for his little fascist project and getting rich.
Right, right. No, the whole thing is ridiculous. But you think that Democrats would instead come to the support to keep Mike Johnson in the speaker's position rather than install Hakeem Jeffries?
Well, it depends on the terms that Marge... the vote, the way in which Marge filed it, they don't have to vote right away. She basically took a sword, put it over Speaker Moses's head, and she's going to try and trigger it at some time that is most useful to her. But a number of Democrats from around the spectrum, Jared Moskowitz is one, Spanberger is another. I didn't say that right, but anyway. Swozy, who is quite moderate, right?
Uh-huh.
But all of them have come out and said, if Marge triggers this because Johnson brings a vote to support Ukraine to the floor, then they will table the resolution to take him out. So, it's going to...
And we should mention that the House goes on recess after today for 2 weeks because Easter.
Yeah. And so it won't happen before those 2 weeks. Mm. Of course, that means that Ukraine won't come up for a vote for 2 weeks either. Yep. But, I guess one of my frustrations is we're having a last minute, as you said, the government might actually technically shut down
That's
over
right.
the weekend because they put it off too long. Why did they put it off too long, Nicole? What were they doing? Oh my gosh, they had to have another dick pics hearing with like two felons and one not yet felon.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of doing their job.
Yes.
And yep. and the press is not pointing that out. They're not even like saying, oh, the reason we're almost going to have a shutdown is because Republicans do this all the time. It's their tantrum. It is their proof that they should not be anywhere near government. That's the first problem with the reporting on it. But the second problem is they should be saying, the reason why Republicans keep having to scramble to keep the government open is because they're having this stunt impeachment based on no evidence whatsoever. It's all they've accumulated. They have not accumulated evidence. They've accumulated the number of accused and convicted felons that they're relying on, and Democrats also, because they called Lev Parnas. But
right. So the hearing, the two main witnesses were Lev Parnas, who was a former Trump acolyte, convicted felon, served time, and is now, come over to the other side and is. He made some pretty hefty allegations, two of which were saying, Pete Sessions sits on your committee and he was in the middle of all this, and also implicated Senator Ron Johnson for, treasonous behavior. I guess I'm not too far off by saying that.
Well, it's not treason because we're not at war with
Got
Russia,
it. But, okay. But treason. Go ahead.
We knew who he was working with. We knew who Parnas was working with. Basically, what he did was name names. He also named Devin Nunes. He named Derek Harvey, who may or may not still be a staffer in the House. He was a HPC staffer when that happened. We knew that Pete Sessions got money I would caution people about letting their caution lapse when they're listening to Lev Parnas
yeah.
either.
Right.
He claimed, for example, that he was not implicated in the Marie Ivanovich firing. Well, the Pete Sessions allegation is tied to the Marie Ivanovich allegation. They just didn't charge him with Farah in the end, because they sort of they charged him with Farah and then took it away, hoping that they could charge both him and Rudy with Farah. And that didn't happen because Rudy's phones were corrupted. So, you know, Parnas can tell stretchers as well. To my mind, the newest allegation, the one allegation that Parnas made that is totally new, is that he said Bill Barr knew of his and Rudy Giuliani's search for dirt on Hunter Biden from the time he was confirmed. So that's February 2019. I haven't written up the implications of that yet, but if you recall, when Parnas got arrested in October 2019, when impeachment is already going, like at the time that Parnas was arrested, Democrats had already subpoenaed him or said they were going to subpoena him. And there was this panic. And actually, Parnas, I just started reading his book. Parnas describes that he returns from meeting with Dmitry Firtash in Vienna, goes directly to Massachusetts to meet with Trump's lawyer, John Dowd, where they figure out how to keep Lev Parnas away from impeachment. Basically, and there was this ridiculous letter that John Dowd wrote saying that it was this intersecting kind of privileged relationship. Rudy was Parnas's lawyer. Parnas was doing work for Dmitry Parnas, Dmitry Firtash. Right. Parnas was doing work for Donald Trump, and therefore it was all privilege. I mean, that was how they were going to keep Lev Parnas away from the impeachment inquiry. And then Parnas gets arrested, and he believes, and, you know, I think there may be merit to the allegation, is that he was arrested and treated in the way he was arrested because not just Rudy and Trump were implicated, Bill Barr was implicated. And so Bill Barr had an interest in, if you read Jeffrey Berman's book, who was the U.S. attorney for New York, for Southern District of New York, he was like, no, we had this plan for a while. And they did. But if Bill Barr knew of the investigative side, you know, if he knew that Parnas was also working for Rudy, at the same time, if he knew that from February 2019, it makes certain investigative non-actions in D.C. far, far, far more damning. Hmm. And I'll write that up. I just didn't get around to it today. But I think that for the first, you know, he's always sort of alluded, Parnas has, to, well, you know, he has said in the past that there was a meeting with Bill Barr and Victoria Tunsig about Dmitry Firtash. And the idea was Dmitry Firtash gets out of jail free by setting up this dirt for Donald Trump on Hunter Biden. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he's sort of, Parnas in the past has sort of nodded to that, but he went much further in his testimony. He said, you know, that after meeting with Bill Barr, Rudy Giuliani told Firtash that he had nothing to worry about, implying that Bill Barr was going to make the Dmitry Firtash case go away so that Rudy Giuliani could get a copy of Hunter Biden's laptop.
Oh, my God.
That's the quid pro quo. And it makes a bunch of other details that we know happened far more interesting. One that I keep harping on over and over again, the day after the FBI got Hunter Biden's laptop in December 2019. So this is 2 months after Lev Parnas is arrested. Will Levy, who was Barr's chief of staff, texted him on his personal cell phone saying, laptop on its way to you. So there's like this hint that Bill Barr may have gotten a copy of the laptop in 2019.
Yeah.
So I don't.
Yeah. So it sounds like it's I use the term, but it's the wrong term. Comedy of errors. It's they're all working against one another. And, the bottom line is sort of what Eric Swalwell said towards the end of the hearing yesterday.
It's time to pack it up. And I want to give you the top 10 reasons why impeachment is dead. Number 10, your key witness today is testifying from the slammer. Number 9, key evidence of a bribe that you all relied on. The guy who said that has been indicted for lying about that bribe, and he's a Russian asset. Number 8, another key witness has been indicted as a Chinese agent. Number 7, during the Hunter Biden interview, Mr. Chairman, you didn't even stay for the whole time. Number 6, Chairman Jason Smith didn't show up at all to the Hunter Biden interview. The same day, number 5, Daryl Issa said, it's a big nothing. Number 4, today Jim Jordan began his remarks not by relying on any evidence for this investigation, but he went off attacking the DOJ about what they're doing with the Catholics. Number 3, you all still have not sent the articles of impeachment for the Mayorkas impeachment to the Senate. And that happened last month. Number 2, you're now talking about a criminal referral, but if you had evidence for a criminal referral, then you have evidence to impeach somebody for high crimes and misdemeanors. And number 1, and I'm sorry to say this, Fox News isn't even carrying this today. In fact, one of their anchors, as they broke away 10 minutes in, said, this is the same hearing over and over and over. At what point are you going to fish or cut bait? So I just have to tell you, it's over. Impeachment's over. Dunzo. Bye-bye. Rigor mortis. Lights out. Curtain drop. Mic drop. Peace. Adios. Sayonara. Au revoir. Or a language that you all understand. Doi civ dania. Did I say that right, Mr. Parnas?
Yes.
I dare you to impeach, but you won't, because you don't have the evidence. And because you don't have the evidence, you don't have the votes. Guys, it's dead. And so I'm here to pronounce the time of death.
There's nothing left to this. You know, they may sustain it because they believe they need to sustain it, because they can't admit to their maggots that there is nothing there. But, it is what it is. I found it. There were actually 3 witnesses. There was Lev Parnas. There was Tony Bobulinski, who in his deposition basically said 9 people had lied and he was telling the truth, including everyone at the FBI he spoke with, which he said was 9 people. I think if you look at his at the interview report, it's something like 5. But he said, they're lying, they're lying, they're lying. And then in the public hearing, he's like, no, I didn't say they were lying. I said that they didn't write down what I told them, because Bobulinski had claimed to the FBI in 2020, right after hanging out with Donald Trump and right before having a hush-hush meeting with Mark Meadows, that he had witnessed this meeting at which Hunter Biden was given this diamond and so on and so forth. So Tony Bobulinski was number 2. The day of that report, Daily Beast had a report of yet further Russian ties that Tony Bobulinski had that kind of conflict what he said in his deposition. And then the third person is Jason Galanis, who testified from prison, who was kind of the mastermind he is in prison on 3 fraud convictions, one of which Devin Archer was involved with. And he was sort of saying, well, I tried to talk to the SDNY about Hunter Biden being involved in this, and they were having none of it. I'm like, yeah, because you're a fraudster. I mean, they wouldn't even listen to Lev Parnas. To be honest, like, there was this undercurrent of the hearing because both Parnas and
Bobulinski,
Galanis, and also Michael Cohen, who's also in the news with this right. week, SDNY prosecuted all of them. And Galanis is like, they treated me unfairly. I'm like, yeah, let's talk about what they did to Lev Parnas. And they did that to Lev Parnas because Bill Barr was interfering in the investigation of Rudy Giuliani. And then let's talk about what they did to Michael Cohen.
Yeah.
And they did it to Michael Cohen because Bill Barr was interfering in the investigation of Donald Trump. And so there's, SDNY is famously independent and famously obnoxious about plea agreements. So like they won't let you cooperate unless you basically give them your soul in a golden box wrapped up, signed away. So both Lev and Cohen said, I'd like to share information with you. And they're like, no, we think you're liars. So they, neither Cohen nor Parnas were able to share any information with SDNY. And as we move towards the Alvin Bragg case against Trump, Trump did, which he's done in every case. And for some reason, the press isn't hip to this yet. But as they've done in every case, they're like, oh my God, discovery violations, we haven't gotten anything. And then you look closer and it's like, well, actually, no. But the issue is that one of the main issues is that, unsurprisingly, Trump wants all of the Michael Cohen case files from SDNY because SDNY is like, Michael Cohen is a liar and a crook. And so Trump wants that to discredit Alvin Bragg's star witness. And that's fair. I mean, Alvin Bragg has known from day one. That's true. So Alvin Bragg asks for the files from the Michael Cohen case file last year in spring of 2023. SDNY is like, here's a bunch of it, but we don't want to give you the phones because it's really onerous. And then Trump subpoenas it from SDNY, and there's back and forth about how much SDNY is going to give them. And Trump makes this argument, you have to give us all the phones. But in the interim period, and this is another Daily Beast report today, that in the interim period, SDNY never had the full 302s from Cohen and Mueller. So they had their own 302s, which was about four or five of them. 302s are the interview report.
Okay.
Right. So you sit down, have an interview with prosecutors. They put it up. They don't, it's not a transcript. They write it up. Don't talk to me about FBI's archaic ways and the stupidity of it. But anyway, so they had those, whatever, four or five 302s, but they only had one of Mueller's 302s when Alvin Bragg first got this discovery. So Alvin Bragg, I'm not even sure if he turned it over because it wasn't relevant. And then in the interim, because Michael Cohen is suing with a reporter, Brian Karam, to get his own case file and his own 302s, mm-hmm. his own unclassified 302s, DOJ finally sent copies of the Mueller 302s to SDNY, and all of a sudden they had them in possession. And so this is the backstory to this panic that Donald Trump manufactured that a lot of journalists credulously believed. So maybe we'll get more details about the Mueller. Mueller had released all of, or I think most of his 302s with Michael Cohen to Jason Leopold as part of his FOIA, but there are three of them that are largely B5s, meaning that that DOJ kept them because that's stuff that didn't make the report. They're deliberate. Okay. And so maybe we'll get more, maybe now Michael Cohen can get all of them and he can release them and talk about what he actually told Mueller. Meanwhile, like SDNY does say that Michael Cohen is a liar. And Judge Furman in SDNY, Michael Cohen keeps saying, can I get off probation? Can I get off probation? And based on the testimony Cohen gave in the Trump Organization fraud case, right? So this is Tish James's case, based on testimony he gave there, where he said, I said I was guilty of tax crimes that I wasn't because that was a way to stave off my spouse being charged. And he's always said that, but he said that under oath. And anyway, the judge who was ruling over whether he could get off of probation said, you either perjured yourself when you pled guilty back in 2018 or you perjured yourself last week. So you've got conflicting things about how big of a liar Michael Cohen is, with Judge Engoron in the Trump Organization case saying, I thought he was credible, more credible certainly than Alan Weinstein.
The CFO of the Trump Organization,
and
Weisselman.
Weisselman. Yeah, I was like, I knew I got it wrong.
Something like that.
Anyway, so Engoron's like, I found him credible. And then Jesse Furman, who's the judge that took over the Michael Cohen federal case, basically said, no, you're a perjurer. So, you know, Alvin Bragg has known he had to deal with this from day one, and we'll see how that trial goes.
Yeah, but the trial that was supposed to begin on Monday, the 25th of March, that Alvin Bragg now agreed, well, we'll delay it until mid-April because of these delayed discovery documents from SDNY, right? That's what this is all about?
Yeah, so there's going to be a hearing next week to decide how long that trial gets delayed. I don't think it's really going to be delayed. I mean, it was a stunt. It worked. At this point, you know, I'm not sure that it helps Donald Trump, right? So Donald Trump, you know, relatedly, Tish James moved to place a lien on Trump's Westchester properties.
Right.
Right. So I think it's a golf course and also the estate that maybe Eric had been living in. And it's this estate that they kind of used a gimmick to get more of it by claiming that they were preserving it. Anyway, so Tish James has taken the first step to seizing property from Donald Trump because he won't put up bond. He won't put up the $500 million bond so that he can appeal. Truth Social purchase is going through today. Yes. So he may get some money on that, but they, you know, it's, he can't take money out of the company without
for like 6 months, right? There. And already I saw a graphic, the stock is tanking on it just on the news that I guess they're taking it public.
Well, it's been going up and down. Okay. I looked back after that first one and I saw that it was back up, but it's going to be volatile. Then there's going to be talk about Elon Musk buying it because of course, God. And you know, I don't think that helps Trump immediately. He still is going to have the Alvin Bragg trial. There were some judgments. There were some rulings from the Alvin Bragg judge that, you know, the only good news for Trump is that the grab them by the pussy video isn't going to be shown, but it can be described at trial. And then the Stormy Daniels documentary, which she didn't have a role in, that's now out. So that's going to start bringing press. So, you know, I don't know. Joe Biden is slowly inching back in the polls. He's above Trump in a number of polls.
Yep. Which we're not seeing reported on nonstop like we were seeing the New York Times and all these other outlets breathlessly. Donald Trump is winning every poll. We're not seeing the reverse now that Biden's numbers are coming up. I just thought I'd throw that in there.
Yeah, I mean, let's wait and see whether the trend continues. Let's, I remain cautiously optimistic. I actually think Biden may win back more than just 1 or 2 points. So we'll see how it goes. I mean, because one thing that Biden has started doing very aggressive. I mean, first of all, one thing that's happened is, was it Lara Trump? Some moron was like, are you better than you were four years ago?
Like, yes.
Let's do that.
Yes.
Let's go ahead. And every day, think about where we were 4 years ago. Like to do that 4 years after the COVID crisis started is just insane. So now we're getting like Joe Biden is sending out these daily updates of this is the moronic thing that Donald Trump said 4 years ago. I think we're still about 5 days short of the bleach in the arm.
Right. But did you see the ad that the Biden campaign released today? I'm looking for it really quickly because it is stunning. It is so good. Let me see if I can't find this and bring it up. Because, you know, the Biden campaign is finally spending the money that they've been taking in because they're running, you know, rings around the Trump campaign. And of course, the money that Trump's taking in is all going to his legal defense. Thank you, Laura Trump, who's now replaced Ronna McDaniels as the chair of the RNC and not giving money to down ballot candidates. It's all going for Donald Trump's legal bills. This can't bode well for the Republicans.
Yeah, I mean, it's now formal, but the fund sharing agreement also went into place. I've lost track of time. It's the last 24 hours.
Yes.
And it is, in fact, the case that if you donate money to Donald Trump, down ballot races get the last dollar behind Donald Trump's defense attorneys.
Yes.
And the defense attorneys are burning through cash at this unbelievable rate. And delaying these cases isn't necessarily going to slow that down. It's just, you know, they're going to incur more and more, you know, more and more billable hours, you know, inventing new reasons for delay. And so, it's what the Republican Party wants. But if I were a Republican in a swing district, I'd be furious, you know, yep. Like all those whatever, you know, those seats in New York that are the basis of the majority right now, those people aren't going to get any funding help. They're not, you know, they've got to put up with Trump's, you know, Trump has come out for a national abortion ban. He's come out against Social Security. He's come out against NATO. He's come out, like, his policies are deeply unpopular, and that's before you, like, account for the basic fascism he's calling for.
That's right. All right, I found
and,
it.
And polling, yeah. By the way, there are increasing numbers of polls that show after Republicans spent all this money getting Republican voters to panic about the border.
Yes.
Trump's refusal to let the Senate vote on the border bill has led those same voters who are in a panic about the border because of stuff that Stephen Miller has done to get them in a panic of the border are now holding Stephen Miller responsible. And so, Donald Trump is being managed by grownups this time around, but between him, them, and the criminal cases, they keep stepping in it over and over again.
Over and over again. All right, I found the ad. My video is a little weird, but I'm going to play it anyway because it's that good. It starts with Joe Biden, well, posted this to Schitter and said, "Donald, I'm glad you asked." And it starts with a Donald Trump thing from Truth Social that asks the question, "Are you better, you know, than you were 4 years ago?" And that's what it just shows on the thing. And it says 4 years
then
ago.
I see the disinfectant. And is there a way we can do something like that by injection inside?
And on a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate your response to this crisis?
I'd rate it a 10. I think we've done a great job.
What do you say to Americans who are watching you right now who are scared?
I say that you're a terrible reporter. That's what I say. Yeah, no, I don't take responsibility at all. We're doing, I think, really, really well.
I'll tell you what.
How? 1,000 Americans are dying a day.
They are dying. That's true. And it is what it is.
Yes. And that's all it says on the screen afterwards, answering the question that it opened with, are you better than you were 4 years ago? Yes. So the Biden campaign is finally starting to spend some of the money they have. That I think will be an effective ad.
To this crisis.
I think, I think that we shouldn't expect Joe Biden to be ahead everywhere.
No.
The numbers in Michigan continue to stink. But I can't imagine they're going to remain that bad, right? Donald Trump does well in Michigan, but he, you know, a combination of things is just going to slowly bear down on him. And then you've got, right, so Tish James has took that step to go get the golf course and go yep. get the estate in Westchester. And Donald Trump, in any normal situation, would declare bankruptcy. He'd do exactly what Alex Jones and Rudy Giuliani did in mm-hmm. the same situation, declare bankruptcy, stave off the lawsuit stuff. But if he were to do that, then it would be declaring defeat. And the reason MAGAs vote for him is because he keeps leading them to believe that he will never be defeated, right? That is why they love him, is because they believe he's going to beat the rap. So do most liberals, right? But it's
for
beginning
different
to
reasons.
Where, well, I mean, yeah, like, it's beginning to weigh him down, and it's beginning to give him, you know, like, we'll see whether the Truth Social thing will relieve that at all, but it's beginning to present him with choices. I mean, I did a stupid poll, which I knew was going to be stupid on Twitter yesterday. I was like, you know, which is, if he has to save one thing, his campaign or his business, which will he save? And, you know, the answer is C, they're related. Like you can't, you like that. This is the problem, is those, the fate of those two things are in conflict right now. But if he were to give up one, then the other would fail. And that's just the campaign that, you know, it's not, if he loses, if he sacrifices his business to win the election, then he's just sunk as well, but he won't have to worry about rent anytime soon because right. he'll be living in a series of prisons. But
oh my God. Yeah. Or the White House or, you know, but whatever. So Marcy Wheeler, okay. It's the one we haven't touched on yet is what's going on down in Florida with Eileen Cannon. Yeah, I mean, I'm tempted to just say she's just nuts and she's a Trumper and needs to be thrown off the bench. But apparently she's making rulings and doing things that just don't make sense. Her latest is she wants the jury to, and please tell me, I'm probably getting it wrong, to look at the classified documents and then decide if they were personal to Trump, personal documents or not.
Well, let me start with, there was a scoop from a guy named David Latt who always reports on goings and comings of judicial clerks, and he disclosed that there's been some turnover in Eileen Cannon's clerks in the last since the indictment, basically, and there are reasons for that, like the you know that at least. As far as we know, those clerks aren't running the press saying, oh, yeah, she beat me or I caught her having sex on the, you know, that like they're not, if there's a scandal to why they left, one of them left because she had a baby, for example. So that does mean that she has been having turmoil in her staffing as it is. She's not terrifically experienced. These are complex issues. So that is one explanation for what's going on. Another thing that I'll say is that whatever else you can say about Eileen Cannon is she has yet to do anything that is appealable. And so like she keeps her decision, like everyone's like, well, she's totally incompetent. She's totally, well, she may be incompetent, but she very competently is avoiding giving Jack Smith cause to appeal to the 11th Circuit where she can get her ass handed to her again. So that is, to my mind, the smartest lens to understand Eileen Cannon, which is that she is throwing a bunch of shit in the way, but doing so in a way that doesn't give Jack Smith any recourse to go appeal it. After the decision that you mentioned, there was a release today of an interim decision about CIPA, C-I-P-A, which is Classified Information Procedures Act. And it's like basically under CIPA, prosecutors can say, here are four things that may be discoverable. We'd like to treat them differently so that Trump still gets what he needs, but so that he doesn't get classified information. And she allowed them to do what they wanted in one case. She deferred parts of the decision in two cases. And then a third, she, you know, like she sort of gave them what they wanted in a couple of cases and sort of said, let's come back to this in a couple of cases. That decision itself isn't wacky. What is wacky is that she's letting Donald Trump do things with discovery that are improper. Like he shouldn't be there in discovery. She's basically allowed him to reverse the order. And so she's saying, well, let's go figure out the discovery order first. So there's that going on. The what you mentioned, which was like 5 days ago, so right. 700 years in the terms of like my brain.
Yes.
She basically gave them an order and said, I mean, in plain language, what she said is, let's pretend Tom Fitton is an attorney. Tom Fitton is the head of Judicial Watch. He's not an attorney. He has a like English bachelor's degree and that's it. You know, he's very litigious. He spends a lot of time suing. He sued Bill Clinton years ago on a fact pattern that is unrelated to Donald Trump's stolen documents. But after Donald Trump was already hoarding documents, Tom Fitton sat down with him and said, here's a theory you can use to rationalize and stealing documents. Prosecutors haven't revealed that they called Tom Fitton to testify, and they know at least what he would testify if they called him to the stand. Because, in fact, what we have reason to believe is that Tom Fitton gave Trump a theory to retroactively justify doing what he did, which doesn't, it involves a time machine. But the more important thing is Tom Fitton is batshit crazy pants. And so Aileen Cannon's order was, in plain language, let's pretend Tom Fitton is an attorney. Let's pretend he's got the law correct.
Right.
And let's pretend he's not batshit crazy. In that scenario, what would jury instructions look like? Now, this is a weird thing to do anyway. Like, you don't get to jury instructions until 6 months from now.
Right.
And it's sort of like she's just trying to figure out how things would work if she made certain decisions. But the underlying problem is that Tom Fitton isn't a lawyer. He's got less background in the law than I do. Tom Fitton doesn't have the law right. He is basically saying, Donald Trump can convert boxes and boxes of classified documents by claiming they're his personally, and then he gets to keep them.
And by invoking the Presidential Records Act, which doesn't say that at all, right?
It says the opposite. Right. Yeah, right. And then, right. And so, you know, I think the a lot of people misunderstood the import of the actual orders that Aileen Cannon gave. I mean, first of all, like, prosecutors are going to have to show the jury these documents in some form to bring this to trial. And, you know, it may be that they'll give them folders and say, okay, you can look at the document, give it to us back. You can look at the document, give it to us back. It may be that they release heavily redacted versions of these for the jurors. But the jurors actually, if they're going to prosecute this, the jurors will get to judge something about the documents. It won't be whether Trump owns them, which is the Tom Fitton crazy pants theory. It will be whether the jury believes, and they're the ones who get to decide whether they believe that this is national defense information. So, like, you're a juror on this case, you're going to look at this document that is about our nuclear programs, and you'll be like, yeah, that's pretty, like, that's national defense. And so that is the way it should work. And Aileen Cannon is sort of like, well, let's pretend that the question for jurors is not, is a nuclear document a national defense information document? But instead, do we think Trump waved his magic hand over a nuclear document, right, which, by the way, a president cannot declassify by himself? Do we think he did that? You know, this is Tom Fitton crazy pants.
Abracadabra, right?
So we don't know how Jack Smith is going to respond, because the order, you know, is batshit crazy pants. It's just batshit crazy pants after batshit crazy pants. But, you know, she has yet to do anything to give Jack Smith some means to appeal. So she's doing something right.
Wow.
If, you know.
Yeah. So George Conway shitted out yesterday after all this, or whenever it happened this week. Okay, I've seen enough. Not only should Aileen Cannon not be sitting on this case, but she should not be sitting on the federal bench at all. This is utterly nuts. And that seems to be the opinion of most, you know, legal minds. Yet you're saying she's taking it right up to the line. So I guess she's cognizant of that, knowing how far she can go before she's removed from the bench.
Yeah, I mean, and look, let me take a step back. You know, I'm covering the federal cases quite closely. I'm covering the other cases with, you know, half an eye. And every single one of these, however, 5-7 cases, people need to understand that normal legal analysis is functioning with a category error, especially in the federal cases, because in the federal cases, Trump plans on getting elected and then making them go away. And so if you approach them and say, are the arguments Trump makes sound? No, they're not sound, but he's making them to Aileen Cannon, who watches nothing but Fox News and probably Newsmax, and so she might believe them. No, they're not sound, but eventually they're going to get to go to Sam Alito, and he'll be somewhat sympathetic. So will Clarence Thomas. But it, you know, to some degree, it doesn't matter. They, like, Trump is not trying to win the case. Trump is trying to do something else with the case. And so that's working. And whatever Aileen Cannon is doing for him, that's working too.
Yeah. Delay, delay, delay is the, you know, is the name of the game. And right now that is working. CNN is now reporting that Fani Willis is going to ask for an August trial date again. Do you know anything about that?
No, that's come out since we, she's going to ask for that. Judge McAfee gave permission to the people who challenged her appointment, her presiding over the case altogether. He gave them permission to appeal. So the question of whether or not she can stay on the case is still an active one. So, you know, whatever, we'll see. It's probably not going to happen. I mean, no. I don't think she's ready to go to trial, but, and she's down a prosecutor, of course.
Yes, she is. Oy, so there's that. So everything's in flux. It's what else is new? Shit keeps hitting the wall. And I think that's part of Trump's strategy. Throw as much against the wall as you can and, you know, fracture our coverage of one, because there's so, I guess that's not only him, it's the things he set in motion by his actions. It's hard to keep it all straight, even when you know, you've got all the time in the world. Marcy, I don't know how you do it. And there's more that we haven't even talked about. So Alexander Smirnoff, there's a photo you have posted at emptywheel.net of Joe and Hunter Biden golfing with a couple of, I guess, Burisma executives. What's the problem with this photograph?
There is no Burisma executive in it. And I actually don't know where the photo is. Now I'm genuinely interested because it came out in 2019. It was released by Tucker Carlson in October 2019. It was one of the first rebuttals to impeachment. And so, you know, did it come from Rudy? I think there's a really good chance it came from Rudy. And then the question is, who did it come from? In any case, what's interesting about it is not like, on my post, I show that Tucker Carlson used it, Fox used it, other people. It went viral in two different phases in 2019 as impeachment was starting. And we don't know who the fourth person in the photo is, but it's not Burisma. It's like Devin Archer, Joe and Hunter. Nancy Mace used it to make a different argument last week. Probably also, you know, that was based on Jason Galanis's claims, which aren't based, you know, don't have corroboration.
Yeah.
But what's interesting about it is in 2020, Alexander Smirnoff gave it to his handler and he said, oh, this is proof that Hunter Biden and Joe Biden were with Zlicheski. And by the time he did that, like his handler, if he had just done a Google match on that document, would have seen a CNN and a USA Today came later, a CNN and another one of those fact-checking sites had already debunked it, right? Mm-hmm. So he should have known that that Smirnoff was basically giving him regurgitated Donald Trump propaganda rather than actual intelligence. And it should raise more questions about the handler in this case, so.
You know, there's so much. I'm glancing over at Shitter now to see what's going on.
What else is breaking?
You know, yeah, because it's constant. Andrew Feinberg, who's a White House correspondent, just tweeted out, "Stand by for news," which it's constant. So I don't know if there's something. Maybe it has to do with Marco Rubio breaking his silence over Trump VP rumors. It's all just insane because, you know, I lived in Florida during the whole Marco Rubio little hands things. And, the fact that all these.
There's at least one other Republican resignation coming in.
Oh.
So the Republican majority is getting narrower and narrower.
So they have this motion to vacate entered by Marge this morning, and they don't have a majority of votes in the House anymore. Ken Buck, to circle back to where we started, you know, he was a founding member of the Freedom Caucus. These are they grew out of the Tea Partiers from 2010 that, you know, were the crazy right wingers. And now he's resigning because of the maggot influence in the House. I mean, it's like there is no basement for this Republican Party. And if they keep losing members, you know, they could install Hakeem Jeffries as speaker.
Yeah. I mean, at some point you might see the Don Bacon say, like, enough with this. I either have to choose Marge or Hakeem Jeffries. And, you know, some of the people who are leaving are the ones who voted for Sanity. So it's not clear that that's going to happen, but they don't want to be part of what's going to come next. They don't, you know, oh, may you live in interesting times, Nicole.
Yes, it's both a blessing and a curse. Great that if things are interesting, I'd rather they be boring. I remember back to the time when we used to talk about slow news days and August was basically written off because nothing happened. We haven't had a slow news day in probably 10 years.
Yep. Yeah. Mike Gallagher is the guy who's resigning next month.
Oh, really?
Which is just weeks away. So
yeah, and Ken Buck is saying goodbye today. At first, he said he wasn't going to run for re-election. Then he just said, "I'm out of here." So,
and it's looking like that's what Gallagher's doing. So that means that Republicans have a 4-seat majority. There's one other person who may be leaving as well. So, could you get to Hakeem Jeffries? Yeah, maybe that would be great. Good. Like,
okay. Now we still got a few more minutes, so I have to ask about Paul Manafort. I thought we had seen the last of him, but
no, of course not.
No, he may come back in as Trump's campaign manager or something.
Apparently he's got a consulting firm in Palm Beach, in West Palm Beach. So, and he's like, oh no, I'm really not part of the campaign. But I readers, watchers may remember that I'm trying to do this series that talks about how Trump convinced Republicans to hate rule of law. And I've started the first part of the post that was meant to describe how the Russian attack in 2016 went down. And I'm trying to get people to think of it a little bit differently. And I start that post. I mean, I was already thinking of starting that post, but the first post in that series, I said, not knowing, I'm like, remember that Paul Manafort framed Yulia Tymoshenko. Part of like his influence peddling was about framing Yulia Tymoshenko and framing her as a criminal. So I did that post already, and I was like, okay, I'll start the next one by talking about how Ukrainian oligarchs and Konstantin Khlimnik knew that Paul Manafort was going to be Donald Trump's campaign manager before. Like they, there's reason to believe they knew in December,
mm-hmm.
right? Mm-hmm. He started pitching it in January, kept pitching it. But they knew at least by December that he was going to end up being the campaign manager. And he was, and because I was working on that post, he was saying like, for example, Konstantin Khlimnik knew that he was going to be campaign. He knew for sure that it was a done deal 2 weeks before it was public, about where we are now, both in time and in what we've learned about Paul Manafort. And so basically the people running the Russian operation knew that Paul Manafort was going to be campaign manager before anyone running the American side of the campaign did. And we're kind of back to that again. And in the same way that, you know, New York Times isn't reporting that Rana, not Romney, is a criminal suspect in both a federal and a state investigation, no one is explaining, like when they explain Paul Manafort, they're like, yeah, he had some tax crime. I'm like, first of all, can we talk about the fact that his tax crime is easily an order of magnitude bigger than Hunter Biden's? Wow. Like, you know, everyone's like, oh, Hunter Biden, you know, total corruption. I'm like, right. So Donald Trump pardoned Paul Manafort in part for tax crimes that are literally an order of magnitude larger than anything alleged against Hunter Biden. But then the other thing is, the coverage, much of it, until I started screaming, ignored that he was also found guilty of laundering money to hide the fact that his influence operation was paid for by Russian-backed oligarchs.
Wow.
And I'm like, that's where you start. You start with the fact that his longtime business associate is now generally claimed to be a Russian spy. And then you talk about the fact that when he was doing politics in the United States, he was laundering the fact that he was being paid by people doing Russian spitting. That's where you start. So, yeah, he's back. And I think that Donald Trump is stuck between he needs Russia to get elected
yeah.
and he doesn't give a fuck. Like at this point, He doesn't give a fuck. Neither does Bibi Netanyahu. None of these people. Nope. They're like, we need to have Trump back in office because that's the way that we get away with our crimes. So Donald Trump doesn't give a fuck. He, if the way for him to get elected is going to be Russian help, he doesn't give a fuck, because if he's president, it's not going to matter. And so we're at that don't give a fuck stage. Why would he bring Manafort back when he's got competent people? That's a good fucking question, isn't it? But if he doesn't give a fuck that we find out that he's getting Russian help, then maybe that explains why he doesn't care that Manafort would be. Anyway.
Wow. It's just chaos. And that's the way they like it. That's the way Trump likes it, because it's the only thing, I guess, that gives him cover, because he can hide behind all the bullshit where nothing makes sense. And that's, you know, that obscures the crimes going on, I guess. I don't know.
I mean, like today he posted on his failing social media site that is briefly having a moment of renaissance. That, oh, I've got $500 million cash,
right?
And, you know, I could spend it either on my campaign or on paying off the bills. And, you know, that conflicted with what his lawyers have said as officers of the court. So now they're going to get in trouble, but he doesn't have the cash. But by claiming he does, right? People like Maggie Haberman made it go viral on Shitter. And so Maggie Haberman, who purports to be a journalist, mm-hmm. nevertheless serves always as this really fundamental part of his propaganda, which is not to make rational arguments and persuade people. It's just to confuse people and get the maggots to believe things that are false, or to believe, you know, like if the New York Times says he's dead broke, and Elon Musk's Shitter says that he's got $500 million in cash, we don't know, but I trust Elon Musk more, so probably he's got the $500 million in cash. That's how he persuades people. It's not persuasion. It's like repetition, fear and irrationality. And if you post Donald Trump's claims without some kind of filter, you are part of that irrationality. You're part of that propaganda campaign.
That's right. And it's spreading. And thanks to the interwebs, I actually have Barb McQuaid coming on the show next week, who just wrote a book about disinformation and misinformation. And I really think that's, you know, the business plan of Fox Not News and Newsmax and all these right wing MAGA blogs and stuff is responsible for where we are now, because too many people believe it. I'll end with this. I wasted too much time early this morning excoriating an old friend of mine, I'll say now former friend, who's gone all in on RFK Jr. And in her reasoning is echoing all these right-wing talking points. We're done with open borders. We're done with, medical lockdowns. We're done. I mean, just it went on and on. And I'm like, yes, I'm willing to trash a 30-year friendship, because this person will not listen to reason facts. I mean, I've been talking news and politics for 15 years now. We come out of my music industry radio days. She'll listen to Joe Rogan and believe what, you know, the nonsense he's spewing, but won't listen to what I have to say. And I do a lot of research, and my opinions are based in fact. I get things wrong, as we all do, but I admit when I get things wrong. The difference is they double down on the bullshit to, I don't know, because they want to bring about the end of democracy. It just makes no sense, and it's infuriating. And yeah, I sort of let her have it this morning, because my patience is like this at this point.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah. So Marcy Wheeler and I trying to save democracy every Friday.
Well, we're getting a new Taoiseach here in Ireland, so I can't even begin to understand that. The Taoiseach, which is the prime minister, basically.
Oh.
It's spelled Taoiseach. I actually made the point of learning that one, but he resigned. So because it's a parliamentary system, his party, which is, you know, kind of the Republican Party, picks a new leader, and that leader is going to become Taoiseach. But, you know, then the question is, do we get a new vote? Do we not get a new vote? It's not really important. I mean, one of the reasons he stepped down, there's no scandal that I know of, although maybe there's a scandal. In any case, one of the reasons is that they brought two things for referendum about 2 weeks ago, and they failed miserably. They failed by astronomical margins. Basically, and I said this, they were trying to take barefoot and pregnant out of the Constitution. That failed, still in the Constitution. So partly it's that they didn't manage that. And people within the party are like, you got distracted from the plan, and it's this tenuous coalition anyway. So that's my exciting civics lesson about Irish politics, which I don't understand. I call up my cousin and I say, tell me,
what's going on?
She knows more about it than I do. She lives in the States. I live here.
Oh, my. It is frightening. And then you see what France did. And they put abortion rights in their constitution. France is not the first country I would think would do that, but they did. So good for them, and nothing makes sense. That's where we are. Marcy Wheeler, anything else that we didn't touch on that you want to say this week?
No, I'll save it for next week, because I'm sure no good news will come.
No.
We have hearings next week. We have, what do we have? We have a hearing in the Hunter Biden case in California. We have a hearing, I already mentioned it. We have a hearing in the Alvin Bragg case in New York. I'm sure Eileen Cannon will do 17 crazy things between now and then. Yep. Donald Trump submitted his brief in immunity and misquoted Brett Kavanaugh. But it'll be a couple weeks until Jack Smith has to respond. There's going to be 12 other things, I promise. But we'll see.
All right. To be continued next Friday. In the meantime, emptywheel.net is where you go for real news. And great research and reporting, hear her sort of bring it all together at the end of the week here. Thank you, Marcy, as always. Have a great weekend, and we'll be back next week. I apologize sincerely for the gremlins today. I have no control over them, but I'll be working on it, on eradicating them over the weekend, I promise. Thanks to Marcy Wheeler. Find her at emptywheel.net. I'm Nicole Sandler. Until next time. Peace out.